Today's daf is daf Yud Zayin, and we'll begin with Rav Ada Braid Rav Yitzhak Omar, which is on the second line from the top. And what we're trying to do is reconcile a stira between the Mishnah in Tamid and the Mishnah in Midos, whereas the Mishnah in Tamid has the Lishkas Hatloim in the northwestern part of the base Moked HaEsh. The Mishnah in Midos has it in the southwestern corner. So again, both Mishnais have the base Hatloim, the Lishkas Hatloim in the west. However, the Machloka seems to be, the Stira seems to be, as to whether or not it's the north part of the west or the south part of the west. And the Gemara, until this point, had assumed that there's no way of reconciling these two Mishnayos, but one Mishnah reflects one Shita, and the other a different Shita. And the final Maskon of the Gemara was that, according to Rabbi Elazar ben Yaakov, he is the author of the Mishnayos, and therefore that's his particular sheet. However, Rav Ada Bered Rav Yitzhak finds another possible reconciliation. Hi Lishka, where was this Lishkas Hatloim located? Aktsuye Mikatsia. It was really somewhere in the middle on the western side. It was between the north and the south on the western side. And Aktsuye Machtse means that you could extend it in both directions. So it was really neither in the south nor in the north. It was somewhere in between. And extending from north to south on the west. And the Gemara explains the following. Why does one Mishnah describe and locate the Lishkas Hatloim on the south, the other on the north? It all depends what your perspective is or where you're entering it. What does that mean? The Asi Mitzafon, if you're coming in from the north, and what you're going to see is in front of you is an empty space. Why? Because the Lishkas Hatloim is situated close to the north, but yet moving towards the south. So Mischazi Le Bidorom, he doesn't see the end of the western side. He sees that at the upper northern corner, there's nothing there. He sees that it's moving towards the south. So he, from his perspective, is going to identify the location of the Lishkas Hatloim is in the south. But the Asi Midorim, if somebody's coming from the south, he doesn't see immediately the Lishkas Hatloim. He sees it moving towards the north. And Mischazi Le Bitzofen, it appears to his vision as if it's in the north. Again, just to summarize, Rav Ada Bered Rav Yitzhak reconciles the two Mishnayos in Tamid and in Midos by saying that it all depends when you enter into the base Moked HaEsh, where you're coming in from. If you're coming in from the north, then you assume that the Lishkas Hatloim, since it didn't begin immediately at the northern end of the base Moked, it's in the south. And if, on the other hand, you came in from the southern side, you didn't see immediately the Lishkas Hatloim, you identified it as if it was coming from the north. So there's no stira between the Mishnah in Tamid, the Mishnah in Tamid, which locates the Lishkas Hatloim in the north, is describing someone who comes from, he enters into the base Moked HaEsh from the south, and from his perspective, it's in the north. And the Mishnah in Midos that identifies the location of the Lishkas Hatloim in the south is discussing, addressing someone who has, because he entered in from the north, he has the perspective, from his perspective, it looks like in the south. However, Rav Ada adds one point here, and he says, "Umistabra, it's more logical to assume that Dibemaravis Dromis Havi, that although the Lishkas Hatloim was both in the north and the south on the western side, but nevertheless, it was primarily in the southern side." In other words, most of the Lishkas Hatloim was located on the south. It didn't reach the exact corner of the south, but the majority of the Lishkas Hatloim was on the southern part of the west of the Lishkas, of the Beis Mokedah H. And even though we said that in the Mishnah in Tamid, the location of the Lishkas Hatloim was on the north, again on the western side, but nevertheless, even the Mishnah in Tamid says Rav Ada would agree that it's on the southern side. In other words, the majority of the Lishkas Hatloim was located on the south. Again, his perspective was that you're coming in from the south, you don't see it exactly in the southern corner. That's why the Mishnah in Tamid identified it as the north. But really, it was located mostly on the south, even according to the Mishnah in Tamid. And Rav Ada says, I'll prove it to you. How does he prove it? Now, by way of introduction, let's mention the following so that we'll understand Rav Ada's proof. The Mishnah in Tamid is not focused on the entire map of the Beis HaMikdash. That's not the focal point or the agenda of the Mishnah in Tamid. The Mishnah in Tamid is talking about Seder Avodah, and specifically of the Karban Tamid. So therefore, what the Mishnah in Masechta Tamid introduces at the very beginning of the Mishnah is that there's certain memuna, there's a certain kohen whose job it was, he was appointed for the purpose of telling the other kohenim that when they're ready for the Karban Tamid every morning, they should go into the Lishkas HaTloim and there they'll find a tlem. And that's the discussion and the focal point of the Mishnah in Tamid. And at some point, almost as a secondary agenda, almost what we call agav urcha, by the by, it mentions where the Lishkas HaTloim was located and describes a little bit of the layout of the Beis Moked Ha'esh, but that wasn't really the focal point. So therefore, let's say you had a kohen in the Azara, and his job it was to go into the Lishkas HaTloim and remove a tlem in order to bring the Karban Tamid in the morning. So he would enter in to the Beis Moked Ha'esh from the south. That's why the Mishnah identifies the location of the Beis Moked of the Lishkas HaTloim as in the north, because when he comes into the south in order to obtain a lamb, he sees that there's no Lishkas HaTloim, he's going to move towards the north, but primarily it's in the south. And what's the proof of this? So now we're going to study the Mishnah in Midos. Again, until now, our focal point was the Mishnah in Tamid. And Midar Aminon, Lechem Apodim, Al Lechem Apodim. There seems to be a problem with locating the Lishkas Lechem Aponim. That's the chamber in which they prepare the Lechem Aponim. Now we focus on the Mishnah in Midos. The Mishnah in Midos identifies the location of the Lishkas Lechem Aponim as the south, but on the eastern side of the Beis Moked Ha'esh. On the other hand, and here's the stira lechora, the Mishnah in Tamid seems to imply that since the Lishkas HaTloim, we said, was in the north on the west, and then it goes through the names of all the various lishakos that were in the Beis Mokidosh. And it mentions the Lishkas HaChosamos and the Lishkas HaEsh, the smaller Moked HaEsh. And finally, he gets to the Lishkas Lechem Aponim. And therefore, it makes sense to assume in interpreting the Mishnah in Tamid that you're talking about a person who is on the outside, and he faces the lichka, the chamber, whatever it is, and he proceeds towards his right side, which means he's going counterclockwise. And if he begins, as it were, to start his morning avoda by taking a tlef from the lichkas hatlaim, which is again on the north, on the western side, but on the north, and he's turning counterclockwise, so then he's going now on the western side, and immediately he's going to encounter the Lishkas HaChosamos, and that's going to be at the southwestern corner. Then he goes over the southern side, and he finally gets to the Lishkas HaEsh, that's on the southeastern corner. And then going up the eastern side, he arrives at the Lishkas Lechem Aponim. So he's now on the northeastern corner. And that is the simple pshat of the Mishnah in Tamid. And in that sense, what we have is that from the simple pshat of the Mishnah, the Lishkas Lechem Aponim was now located in the northeastern side of the Beis Moked HaEsh. But according to the Mishnah in Midos, we said it was not on the northeastern side, but rather on the southeastern side. And therefore we have Lechora Stira between the two Mishnahs. So again, although the explicit location, identification of the place of the Lishkas Lechem Aponim is only in the Mishnah in Midos, which puts it in the southeast, but by simple, let's say, we'll call it detective work, if we follow the way that the person is moving from one lishka to the other, we end up coming to the conclusion that the Mishnah in Tamid would locate the lishkas Beis Lechem Aponim on the northeastern side, not the southeastern side. So again, it's not an explicit stira, but it's quite close to a contradiction. And now, Chaninan, how do we reconcile this apparent contradiction? Amar Rav Huna, Breder Rav Yeshua, we have a statement of Rav Huna. Mar Kachoshiv Derech Yemin, Umar Kachoshiv Derech Smol. There is no stira between the two Mishnayos. And they would both agree that the exact precise location of the Lishkas Lechem Aponim was in the southeast. And that's Mefurash in the Mishnah in Midos. It's on the southeastern corner of the Beis Moked HaEsh. Now, according to the Mishnah in Midos, says Rav Huna, we are following the following order. The order is counterclockwise. So if you're going to begin with the Lishkas HaTloim, which we said was on the southwestern side, and then you go to the southeastern side, you end up identifying the Lishkas Lechem Aponim on the southeastern side. The Mishnah in Tamid doesn't mention which direction it's going. And so Rav Huna suggests that let's assume that it's describing the position of the chambers, the various lishakos, from right to left, the kachoshuv derech yamin, which means clockwise. And if you go clockwise as opposed to counterclockwise, then you end up that even the Mishnah in Tamid will identify as the Mishnah in Midos the Lishkas Lechem Aponim on the south, on the southeast. Okay, now how does that impact on our discussion about the reconciliation of Rav Ada of the two Mishnayos in Tamid and in Midos regarding the location of the Lechem, of the Lishkas HaTloim? Now we turn to Daf Yud Zayin Amid Beis. And here's what we have. Iyamid Bishleimu B'marovis Dromis Havi. If you're going to tell me that the majority, the main primary extent or volume of the Lishkas HaTloim is on the south, Hainin Dimitaritz Lechem Aponim Alechem Aponim. Now the answer of Rav Huna that we offered before on the apparent contradiction regarding Lechem Aponim Lishka is now reconciled. Because we're going to say that the Mishnah in Tamid is listing the Lishakos in the direction of right to left. So let's focus for a moment on the Mishnah in Tamid. The Mishnah in Tamid gives you the entire list, the enumerates the list of the Lishakos in the following Seder. He starts with the Lishkas HaTloim. He goes to the Lishkas HaChosomos, and then from there to the Beis Moked HaKotan, and then he goes to the Lishaka, to the Lishka of the Lechem Aponim. Now, if we assume that the Lishkas HaTloim was primarily in the south, on the west, again in the Lishkas Beis HaMoked, then it begins near the south corner, the southwestern corner, of course, and then it begins from the southwest, and according to Rav Huna, if he's going from right to left in the Mishnah Tamid, meaning clockwise, then he's going from the Lishkas HaTloim in the south, again on the western side, over to the Lishkas HaChosomos, the Lishkas Beis HaMoked, and now he ends up in the Lechem Aponim. The Lishkas Lechem Aponim is in the southeast, which is exactly what it says in the Mishnah in Midos. So when the Mishnah in Tamid identifies the Lishka of the Tloim as being in the north, it merely means that if you enter into the Beis Moked HaH from the south, it looks as if, from that perspective, the Lishka of the Tloim is located in the north, but really it's located primarily in the south. And therefore, if it's closer to the south, then as we explain, the Mishnah in Tamid is talking about a situation where he turns from right to left. And in doing so, when he makes the clockwise circuit around the Beis HaMoked, he ends up at the Lishkas Lechem Aponim on the south, on the southeastern side. But if on the other hand, you're going to tell me that primarily the Lishkas HaTloim was located in the north on the western side, meaning you're going to take the Mishnah and Tamid literally, then sof, my terutzo de lechem upon it, you will have absolutely no reconciliation of the apparent contradiction between the two Mishnais as to the location of the lechem upon it, the Lishkas lechem upon it. And the reason for that, because if you take the Mishnah in Tamid literally that the Lishkas HaTloim was located in the north, on the western side in the north, then even if we assume that by enumerating all the Lishakos in the direction of right to left, we're going to end up with a contradiction to the Mishnah in Midos with regard to location of the Lishkas Lechem Aponim, because we're going to circle around the entire Beis Moked HaH starting from the northwest. And that's the location, according to the literal pshat in the Mishnah Tamid, of the Lishkas HaTloim. And then we're going to go through the various Lishakos that are enumerated in the Mishnah by turning clockwise, which means he's going to go from the north, turning left, and till he makes his round, he's going to end up with the Lishkas Lechem Aponim on the southwestern corner, which is against the Mishnah Midos. Elolav Shmamino b'marovis dromis havoy Shmamino. Therefore, we have to assume that the main part of the main bulk, shall we say, of the Lishkas HaTfilin was actually located in the south. Now the Gemara raised an objection, because according to Rav Huna, when the Mishnah in Tamid is listing the Lishakos, and you're going from right to left, then basically you're facing the small, right? Because you're starting on that side of the Lishkas Beis HaMoke. In other words, the halacha is that whenever you're involved in any avoda, you always turn towards the yamin, and that would mean from right to left. But the Gemara answers, no, you don't understand. Hani mili b'avoda, when you talk about the Kohen who's actually doing the avoda, this is the sequence that he should follow. He should proceed from yamin to small, from right to left. Aval hacha, but here in this Mishnah, he's not telling you exactly how the Kohen is going from one place to the other when he's implementing his avoda. Chushbeno bi'almahu. He's simply trying to locate all the different lishakos. He's not talking about the Seder avoda. So, for example, if a Kohen is doing the avoda saddam, so he's always going to turn towards the right. But when the Mishnah is telling you and enumerating all the various lishakos in the base moked ha'esh, it's not telling you in what order you actually should do the avoda. And now at this point, we end that sugya. We begin to go back to the Mishnah and analyze the Kohen Gadol's rights, his special rights in the Mishnah. It says, Shekohen Gadol makriv chelik barosh v'notel chelik barosh. Number one, the Kohen Gadol has first rights to be makriv any carbon that he wants, as I state in the Mishnah, and he can take any portion of the carbonos and decide that this zevach, this basar, he's going to eat the basar. And now we want to get into some of the nitty-gritty details. Tanu Rabbanan, we learned in a brisa, ketzad makriv chelik barosh. What does the Mishnah have in mind when it says that he can exercise his rights as Kohen Gadol to be makriv any carbon that he wants to? Omer, he can declare, olazu, the anche beis ha-mishmar on the base of os are now coming to be makriv this ola. Ani makriv. I want to be makriv the ola. Mincha zu ani makriv. There's a mincha, and despite the fact that there was a Kohen who was now singled out to do the hakrovas ha-mincha, I want to do the hakrovas. That's the declaration of the Kohen Gadol. Ketzad, period. Now we go to the next part of this statement in the Mishnah. Ketzad notel chelik barosh. The Braisa asks, what does it mean that he has first rights to decide which part of the carbon the basar he wants to eat? Omer, he could declare, chatazu ani ochel. I'm going to eat the carbon, the basar that the Kohen is allowed to eat of the chatas. Hashem zeh ani ochel. I'm going to eat the basar of the ocean. So that's the rights of the Kohen Gadol. He could take that which he wants to eat from the basar. He can take a choice portion, whatever he likes. And it would seem that he could take all the meat that he wants, the entire carbon. However, the next part of this brisa seems to indicate that the Kohen Gadol does not have rights to take the entire carbon, because let's say on Chag HaShavuos there was a mitzvah of bringing shtei alechem. Here the brisa says notel chala, meaning one chala mishtei hachalas, which means that the maximum the Kohen Gadol has rights to demand for himself is 50%. And in the case of lechem haponim, there were 12 lechem haponim, but we're going to see later on in Daf Yud Ches that two at the lechem haponim were designated as gifts for certain specific individuals. So we're left with giving up 10 lachmei ponim. And here the Braisa records a machlokas. The Tanakam of this Braisa holds arba o chamesh mimase lechem haponim. Out of the 10 breads, loaves of bread that are being divvied up amongst the Kohanim at the end of the Shabbos when they take off last week's Lechem Aponim from the Shulchan, the Kohen Gadol could demand 4 or 5. Now again, we're not sure why the Brisa mentions 4 or 5. What are the significance of those two numbers? That's going to be the Sugya Daf Yud Ches for tomorrow. But what we do see is that the Kohen Gadol is getting less than a half. Until now, we said that with regard to the basar, he gets all the basar he wants. With regard to the Shtei Lechem on Shavuos, he gets 50%. And now we're saying that with regard to Lechem Aponim, he gets less than 50%. Rebbe Omer, Rebbe says, Li Olam Chamesh. It's always going to be 5. 5 is 50% of 10. And again, 2 Lechemim they had to give to a gift for somebody. Shenemar, now the Bnei Aaron are considered the regular Kohanim. Aaron is the Kohen Gadol. And since the Torah equates them, Aaron u'banav, it's mashma, mechzel Aaron and mechzel banav. So that whereas Rebbe works, operates with the 50% ball, that means that the Kohen Gadol always has rights to 50%. And in the case of Shtei Lechem, that makes sense. He gets 1 out of 2. In the case of Lechem Pon, he gets 5 out of 10. The Chachamim insist, at least in the case of Lechem Aponim, that the Kohen Gadol gets less than a half. And apparently the Tanakhama, the Chacham, never accepted this equation between Aaron and Bonav. But again, the question is going to have to be, according to the Rabbanon, you're not being consistent. In the case of Shtei Lechem on Chag HaShavuos, you're giving the Kohen rights to 1 out of 2. That's 50%. And in the case of Lechem Aponim, you're giving him 4? Which is less than 50%? Hagufa kasha. The Gemara raises the following self-contradiction within the Braisa. Amrit, you tell me, no till chalachas v'shtei chalos, which means you're following the 50% halacha, which is a reflection, Mani, of Rebbe, he, the Omer Palgo Shokel, he derives from Aaron Ubanov that the Kohen Gadol gets 50%. So that when we talk about divvying up the Shtei Lechem on Chag HaShavuos and the Kohen Gadol gets 1 out of 2 challahs, that means you're following the Shita of Rebbe. Ema Mitziyosa. Let's go on in the Braisa. In the case of the Lechem Aponim, Arba O Chamesh Mimaisa Lechem Aponim. Now, if you're only giving 4 out of 10 Lechamim of the Lechem Aponim to the Kohen Gadol, that's the maximum rights he has, Asan L'Rabbanon, that can only reflect the Shita L'Rabbanon, who rejected Rebbe's equal and allowing the Kohen Gadol to get as much as 50%. The Amri, the Chachamim say, Lo Shakil Palga, he has to get the minority, can't get half. But then Ema Seifa, Rebbe Omer Li Olam Chamech, that he gets 5 out of 10. So it's very strange. You started with 1 out of 2, which is 50%. You end up with quoting Rebbe as 5 out of 10. So that's Reish of a Sefer Rebbe. The Reish in the case of Shtei Lechem reflects Rebbe Shita of 50%. The Sefer explicitly quotes Rebbe 5 out of 10 in the case of Lechem Aponim. But Mitziasa Rabbanon. But in the middle, you mention the Shita of the Chachamim, that in the case of Lechem Aponim, the maximum rights that the Kohen Gadol has is for four, or at least that's one option, 4 out of 10. Amar Abaye. Abaye says, Reisha umitzi asa Rabbanon. Even in the case of Shtei Lechem, no, let me say it this way. In the case of Shtei Lechem, even Chachamim will agree that the Kohen Gadol gets 1 full loaf, which is 50%. Really, he should be getting less than a full loaf, because the Chachamim l'shitasim hold, and we saw this in Lechem Aponim, that he's going to get, the Kohen Gadol gets rights to 4 out of 10. Kohen Gadol gets less than a half. You'll ask me why in Shtei Lechem on Yom Kippur, on Shavuos, are we giving him 1 full lechem? Modu Rabbanon, the Rabbanon agreed to Rebbe Shita that there are situations or conditions in which the Kohen Gadol will have to get a minimum of half, meaning 1 out of 2 lechamim of the Shtei Lechem. Why is that? The lavu rech ara lemesiv lekohen Gadol. I skipped one word. I'm sorry. Moda Rabbanan beprusa. That's the key word here, prusa. If you're going to max out the Kohen Gadol's rights to less than 50%, he can't go up to 50%. You're going to have to break the lechem of the shtel lechem, one of the two lechamim, break off a piece, and then give the Kohen Gadol the remainder, the balance of that lechem of the shtel lechem, which is less than a full piece. That's sort of an insult to the Kohen Gadol. So we're trying to balance. On the one hand, we really want the Kohen Gadol to be an unav. You know, he should be humble about it. He should take less than half. But we cannot insult the Kohen Gadol, and we have to give him a full lech. So this, Rabosi, is where we're going to stop for today. And Emir Sashem, tomorrow we'll pick up on Daf Yud Ches. Wishing you a great day.